21 lessons for the 21st century immigration. Debate 2. The second clause of the immigration deal says that if they are allowed in, the immigrant have an obligation to assimilate into the local culture. But how far should assimilation go if immigrants move from a political society to a liberal society? Must they become feminist? If they come from a deeply religious society, did they adopt a secular worldview? Should they abandon their traditional dress code and put taboo? Anti-immigrationists tend to place the bar high, whereas pro-immigrants place it much lower. Pro-immigrantists argue Europe itself are extremely diverse, and its native population have a wide spectrum of opinion, habit, and value. This is exactly what makes Europe vibrant and strong. Why should immigrants be forced to adhere to some imaginary European identity that few Europeans actually live up to? Do you want to force Muslim immigrants to the United Kingdom to become Christian, when many British citizens hardly go to church? Do you want to demand that immigrants from the Punjab give up their curry masala in favor of fish and chips and Yorkshire pudding? If Europe has any real core value, then they are the liberal value, the tolerance and freedom, which implied Europeans should show tolerance toward immigrants too, and follow them as much freedom as possible to follow their own tradition. Provide these two not harm the freedom and right of other people. Anti-immigrantists agree that tolerance and freedom are the most important European value, and cause many immigrant groups, especially from Muslim countries, of intolerance, misogyny, homophobia, and anti-Semitism, precisely because Europe cherishes tolerance. We cannot allow in too many intolerant people. With a tolerant society, can manage small, illiberal minority. If the number of such extremists exceed a certain threshold, the whole nature of society changes. If Europe allows in too many immigrants from the Middle East, it will end up looking like the Muslim East. Other anti-immigrantists go much further. They point out that a national community is far more than a collection of people who tolerate each other. Therefore, it's not enough that immigrants adhere to European standards of tolerance. They must also adopt many of the unique characteristics of British, German, or Swedish culture, whatever they may be. By allowing them in, the local culture is taking upon itself a big risk and a huge expense. There is no reason it should destroy itself as well. It offers eventual full equality, so it demands full assimilation. If the immigrants have an issue with a certain quirk of British, German, and Swedish culture, they are welcome to go elsewhere. The two key issues of this debate are the disagreement about immigrant intolerance and the disagreement about European identity. If immigrant is indeed guilty of incurable intolerance, many liberal Europeans who currently favor immigrant will sooner or later come around opposite it bitterly. Conversely, if most immigrants prove to be liberal and broad-minded in their attitude toward religion, gender, and politics, this will disarm some of the most effective argument against immigration. This will still leave open, however, the question of European unique national identity. Tolerance is a universal value. Are there any unique Franks known and value that should be accepted by someone immigrating to France? And are other unique Danish norms and value that immigrants to Denmark must embrace? As long as Europeans are bitterly divided about this question, they can hardly have a clear policy about immigration. Conversely, once Europeans know who they are, 500 million Europeans should have no difficulty absorbing a few million refugees or turning them away. Debate 3. The third clause of immigration deal says that if immigration indeed make a sincere effort to assimilate, they in particular to adopt the value of tolerance, a host country is duty-bound to treat them as a first-class citizen. But exactly how much time need to pass for the immigrant become full member of society? Should immigrant from Algeria feel great if they are still not seen as fully friends after 20 years in the country? How about the second-generation immigrant whose grandparent came to France in the 1970s? Pro-immigrantists tend to demand a speed acceptance, whereas anti-immigrants want a much longer probation period. For pro-immigration, if third-generation immigrants are not seen and treated as weaker citizens, this means that the host country is not fulfilling its obligation, and if this results in tension, hostility, or even violence, the host country has nobody to blame but its own bigotry. For anti-immigrantists, these inflated expectations are a large part of the problem. The immigrant should be patient. If your grandparents arrived here just 4 years ago and you now riot in the street because you think you are not being treated as a native, then you have failed the test. The root issue of this debate concerns the gap between personal timescale and collective timescale. From the viewpoint of a human collective, 40 years is a short time. It's hard to exact society to fill a sub-foreign group within a few decades. Past civilizations that assimilated foreigners and made them equal citizens, such as Imperial Rome, the Muslim Caliphate, the Chinese Empire, and the United States, all took countries rather than decades to accomplish the transformation. From a personal viewpoint, however, 40 years can be an eternity. For a teenager born in France, 20 years after her grandparents immigrated there, the journey from Angia to Marseille is ancient history. She was born here. All her friends were born here. He speaks French rather than Arabic, and she has never been to Algeria. France is the only home she has ever known. And now, people said to her, it's not her home, and that she should go back to a place to never inhabited. It's as if you take a seed of a eucalyptus tree from Australia and planted in France. From an ecological perspective, eucalyptus trees are an invading species, and it will take generations before botanists reclassify them as native European plants. Yet, from the viewpoint of the individual tree, it's a branch. If you don't water it, the branch water, it will wither. If you try to uproot it, we'll discover it has a stalk, it roots deep into French soil, just like a local walks and finds. Debate 4. On the top of all disagreement regarding the exact definition of the immigration deal, the ultimate question is whether the deal is actually working. Are both sides living up to their obligation? Anti-immigrantists trying to argue that the immigrants are not fulfilling term number two. They are not making a sincere effort to assimilate, and too many of them stick to intolerant and bigoted worldview. Therefore, the host country has no reason to fulfill term number three to treat them as first-class citizens, and has every reason to reconsider term number one to allow them in. If people from a particular culture have consistently proven themselves unwilling to live up to immigration deal, why allow more of them in and create an even bigger problem? Pro-immigrantists reply that it's the host country that failed to fulfill its side of the deal, despite the honest effort of the vast majority of immigrants to assimilate. The hosts are making it difficult for them to do so. Worse still, those immigrants who successfully assimilate are still treated as second-class citizens, even in the second and third generation. It's of course possible that both sides are not living up to their commitment, thereby fooling each other's suspicions and resentment in an escalating vicious circle. The post-debate cannot be resolved before classifying the exact definition of the three terms, as long as we don't know whether absorption is duty or a favor, what level of assimilation is required for an immigrant, and how quickly host countries should treat them as equal citizens. We cannot judge whether the two sides of fulfillment their obligations. The additional problem concern accounting. When evaluating the immigration deal, both sides give far more weight to violation than to compliance. If a million immigrants are law-abiding citizens, but 100 joined terrorist groups and attacked the host country, does it mean that immigrants are complying with the term of a deal or violating them? If a third-generation immigrant walked down the street a thousand times without being molested, but once in a while some racist shout abuse at her, does it mean the native population is accepting or rejecting the immigrant? Yeah. Underneath, all this debate rocks a far more fundamental question, which concerns our understanding of human culture. Do we enter the immigration debate with the assumption that all cultures are inherently equal, or do we think that some cultures might well be superior to others? When Germans argue over the absorption of a million Syrian refugees, can they ever be justified in thinking that German culture is in some way better than Syrian culture? Huh.